Northern governors reject VAT laws enacted by Lagos and Rivers states. Credit to private sector rises by 498.6 billion naira in the month of August. Asia Pacific stocks mixed as economies cut China's GDP forecast. In all, exchange rally into sixth day on tight supply, with Brent hitting 3 years high as it crosses $80 per barrel. Details of these and more on Business Express on the network service of the NTA. And we're reaching you live from Abuja, Nigeria's capital. I'm Leah Katung. Baba Tunde. A very good morning to you on this very cold Tuesday from the capital city, Abuja. The Central Bank of Nigeria says credit to private sector went up by 498.6 billion naira in the month of August to 33.26 trillion naira from 32.8 trillion naira reported in July 2021. The 33.36 trillion naira figure announced by the CBN is a new record that was fueled by banks, among others, increased lending to real sector. CBN, in its money and credit statistics for the period, revealed that credit to private sector in January was 30.65 trillion naira and dropped by 0.47% to 30.5 trillion naira in February. However, in March, it closed at 31.44 trillion naira and crossed the 32.1 trillion naira mark in April to 32.12 trillion naira. In addition, the CBN reported 32.63 trillion naira and 33.36 trillion naira credit to private sectors in May and June. Now, Nigeria is set to boost its volume of trade with Russia, which was $600 million before the pandemic, with a faster recovery in sight. The Nigerian-Russia Chamber of Commerce is strategizing on expanding trade engagement through technological advancement in industry, agriculture, and manufacturing.
Producing high-quality products on the world level, from high-tech to fertilizer.
Nigeria can actually be a big window of Russia into Africa. We are prepared to play that role. We've gotten all the necessary assurances from the government in the person of the Vice President of Nigeria.
The Nigeria Open Government Partnership, OGP, says Nigeria has made modest achievements in the implementation of the second National Action Plan, NAP2, even as it is committed to the timely delivery of the plan before the September 2022 deadline. National coordinator of the program, Anne Nzegwu, gave the insight during the third quarter meeting of the OGP thematic working groups in Abuja.
It is heartwarming to report that within the NAP2 implementation period, Nigeria has made great strides in the global OGP community. One of such is that Nigeria won a seat to serve a second tenure in the OGP Global Steering Committee, which will commence from October 1st. this year for the next 3 years.
One thing is clear, that the countries that have chosen to implement their national action plan are the countries that are truly committed to democracy. And this will be true for Nigeria if we will not just tick the boxes and pay lip service to our commitments.
Implementing the action plan to get concrete results and reforms, that's the key. Because 2 years ago when we left Canada, they told us OGP is going to focus on participation, inclusion, and impact. So that impact is the most critical. And you can only get impact from participation, from implementing what you have committed to.
The OGP Technical Working Group meeting enables members to discuss implementation achievements and challenges. This is with a view to preferring solutions and influencing good practice collaboratively for efficient and sustainable public reforms. The federal government, in partnership with the private sector, is set to launch a digital platform that will enable the standardization of products produced by small business owners in Nigeria. This will include subsidized patenting and trademarking of innovations and products for the local and international markets.
That basket you're weaving in Maiduguri can actually be a money spinner internationally. That adire you're doing in Abeokuta, that upa that you're doing in Enugu can be a money spinner if a little standardization is done.
Northern Governors Forum on Monday kicked against the value-added tax laws enacted by the governors of Rivers and Lagos states, which got the support of other southern state governors. The forum, in an emergency meeting in Kaduna State, said their counterparts in the south are confusing VAT for sales tax. Chairman of the forum and Plateau State Governor Simon Lalong read the resolution after over 4 hours meeting in Kaduna, the capital of Kaduna State.
If every state enacted its own VAT law, multiple taxation will result in increase of prices of goods and services and collapse in interstate trade. VAT is not a production tax like excise, but terminal tax which is paid by the ultimate consumer. Until and unless the Supreme Court pronounces judgment on the substantive matter between Rivers State and the federal government, the matter is sub judice. And Northern State Governors Forum would respect this.
Now, the West African Tax Administration's forum, WATF, is leading conversation on taxation of digital economy in a bid to mobilize resources to promote sustainable development in the continent. This was the fallout of a policy dialogue by the forum in Abuja.
Special General Assembly of Tax Administrators in the West African sub-region provides a unique opportunity for frank and forthright discussions on how best we can protect our interests and maximize our benefits, not just as individual countries, but as a regional bloc.
Devising means to tax the untapped digital economy could be the solution to solving Africa's perennial physical deficit problems. Africa has the largest youthful population and fast-growing internet penetration. These two factors present a great opportunity to African countries to maximize revenue to bridge the infrastructural gap upon which the digital economy hinges.
And of course, the West African Tax Administrators policy dialogue may have come and gone, but we are going to still look into some of the issues that came up just last week. And I'm now being joined by Mr. Babatunde Oladapo. He's Executive Secretary of the West African Tax Administrators, WATAF. You're welcome to Business Express.
Yeah, good morning to you, and thanks for having me here.
Yeah, great. So yeah. I'm going to still ask this question. Really, a lot of people are asking, why do we need to tax the digital economy, and can we tax the digital economy?
Yeah, good question. I wouldn't blame people when they ask such question, because there's always that fear about, with this impact on goods and services, will it make the prices of the services I've been accessing to jump up? But that's not a fair DAO. That's not the major focus in the taxation of digital economy. The major focus is to ensure that not only Nigerian, African countries and developing countries get the best from the digital economy. Let me paint the scenario. Previously, as it is, businesses are known to be confined within the brick and mortar framework. You have to have a business address. When you want to go, they say plot, so. Mm-hmm. But now businesses have gone virtuous. And the way transactions are going, within microseconds, you could have transactions that has millions of dollars in implication. So the question is, most of these transactions, the current law we used to have, which is over 100 years old in terms of development in taxing international trade domain, they are derived from laws that started 100 years ago. They are not fit for where we are because the face of business has changed. Yes, you may have businesses still being within the confines of businesses, houses and rooms, but now digital transactions here are here to stay. So for Nigeria to actually get the best, to stop multinational enterprises and others not multinational, because we cannot ignore the fact that there are digital transactions increasing in Nigeria, it's just to ensure that they pay their own fair of taxes. Just like you and I will pay our taxes on our income, businesses that we see pay company income tax. So all those businesses that are not resident in Nigeria or people transacting businesses online that you cannot put a face to them fiscally, they also need to pay. So it's about equity, it's about looking for what other frontier can we explore.
Okay, talking and looking into these frontiers, Facebook doesn't have any fiscal address as such. Uber doesn't have any fiscal address as such, as you have pointed out. And they are all here. Bolt is here. And they just don't have any address here. And then we are consuming them. We're using their services with no addresses here. So how do you make these companies pay tax in jurisdictions where they don't even have addresses, as you've pointed out?
Okay, so yeah, the tax policy experts on the government side in Nigeria recognizes this fact. It's a challenge, but for every problem, there is a solution. Taxation is based on the issue of law, tax policy, and tax administration. And for tax administration to be effective, you need to have relevant laws. Law, if it's not in the law, you cannot tax it. When you look at what has been done in Nigeria, which is significant and needs to be applauded, the Finance Act, I will tell you, it's a bravo initiative. Previously, you have to wait months on end, years on end, for a single amendment to the tax law. But now, with the advent of the Finance Act, a lot has been done by the tax administration, FRA, Federal Inland Revenue Service in this case, and the Finance Ministry, and generally by the Nigerian government. So previously within the Company Income Tax Act, Section 13 in particular, I think Section 2, speaks specifically in terms of how do you tax companies for company income tax. The parameters used to be you need to have a physical presence, you need to have an agent, you need to execute turnkey projects. But those people, multinationals like the Facebooks of this world, they know all the rules. So it's a smart move on their part. Yeah, we don't have any more. We don't have someone appointed as our agent. We are not doing any turnkey project. We don't have physical. So they just walk away with their hamstringing. But the Nigerian government is up to the task. So now the amendment introduced has brought the issue of a significant economic presence. So there's a threshold. For instance, Facebook has, as I did, it's a publicly available information, like 26 million users. And some of them transact business. When you click on Facebook or you go to what's this YouTube, you know what it means.
All the adverts
so
there.
The money goes away with us. So now it says, okay, if you have a threshold of, if we can quantify the transactions you make at the threshold of 25 million naira, you are meant to pay your company income tax. Note, it is not on the capital of the business. It's on your profit. Mm-hmm. So as long as you are making 25 million on above, you are liable to register to pay your company income tax.
So who enforces this registration and happening? Do we need the intervention of the National Assembly to back up the Finance Act, for instance?
Yeah, the Financing Act itself is law. So it has the power of law. It's binding. There are penalties. So in this instance, the operating arm of government is the Federal Inland Revenue Service. So the FRS is the one collaborating with other agencies of government to make sure that these are done the way it should. So failure to do it means the same sanction that applies to a company that does not pay company income tax, a fiscally resident, also applies to you.
Okay, so what would be the difference WATF is making in mobilizing resources for development on the continent of Africa? And while we're looking at that, because I'm told my time is almost up, will also be you, can you just wrap it and also add what happens to startups within this space, that palpable fear?
Okay, yeah. WATF has a mandate to improve capacity of tax administrations. That's a key mandate, and we take it serious. Mm-hmm. And we do that by organizing capacity building events, trainings, facilitating peer learning experiences. Because when you share experience, you learn. Mm-hmm. The fact is, you don't know everything. There are others who know something you don't know. And the way the world is going, tax administration needs to stop playing catch up. And that's why the likes of WATF and other international organizations exist, to make sure that we provide the linkages and access to any resources that will enhance the ability, capacity, and skill set. And then talking about startups, that fear is unfounded. Because through the also this time around, again, the Finance Act 2019-2020, there's a baseline. It's a company that don't get make profit of 25 million, they are off. So it's not going to affect them, it's not going to stifle entrepreneurship, it's not going to run them out of business. But once you cross the threshold of 25 million, you will agree with me that it's legitimate to pay your taxes.
Yeah, sure, I would agree with that. Yes, and thank you so much, Mr. Babatunde Oladapo, for always spending time with us. Victory Oguchukwu tells us how he is bouncing back after COVID-19 restrictions were lifted, and that's next on our Surviving COVID-19 series.
Surviving COVID-19 series is brought to you in partnership with the Central Bank of Nigeria.
I'm an artist, a printer precisely. It affects us really because this is the only place we find our daily bread. So that time the government locked up all the market in Abuja. Then it affected us so many ways because we don't come out. We are locked down in the house, and we don't come out to find our daily bread. So it affects us. I can't say if I come, when I can say is when I come out and get something doing, I can save. But when I don't come out in a day, 1 week, 2 weeks, I will be eating the ones I've saved. Then it will affect me. We think that business have opened. Business have not really opened. Because you see, boys all over this place, everybody is standing. If we are working, you won't see anybody here. Everybody have handwork. All of us here. I don't know the source. There are so many fraud in the network. So you don't know where to apply. Tomorrow they will even ask you to bring something. Before you know it, the little one you are saving for yourself, you end up, they will end up collecting it from you.
But if you know the source, what would you do?
I will apply. I will humbly apply because this is my country. I am a citizen of Nigeria. I believe I have the right to apply to benefit from this country.
Surviving COVID-19 series is brought to you in partnership with the Central Bank of Nigeria.
And of course, we move now straight to the international commodities market. Global energy demand is set to increase from 275.4 million barrels of oil equivalent a day in 2020 to 352 million barrels of oil equivalent a day by the year 2045. Non-Organization for Economic Cooperation and Development primary energy demand is expected to constitute well over 70% of global primary energy demands in the long term, growing from 174 million barrels of oil equivalent a day in 2020 to 250 million barrels of oil equivalent a day in 2045. And we move now to the equities market, where Nigerian stocks opened the week in the red, diminishing by 0.25%. The All Share Index closed Monday at 38,864.33 basis points, and that will be the opening figures this morning. And we move now to the global market with Bosde Abel.
European stocks retreated on Tuesday as global investors monitored a spike in U.S. bond yields and Chinese growth concerns. The pan-European stock 600 fell 0.6% in early trade, with tech stocks dropping 2.1% to lead losses, while oil and gas stocks added 1.2%. Stocks in Asia-Pacific were mostly lower in Tuesday's trade as various firms downgraded China's GDP forecast. Hong Kong's Hang Seng Index led gains regionally, jumping 1.73% as of its final hour of trading. Mainland Chinese stocks closed mixed, with the Shanghai Composite up 0.55% to 3,602.56, while the Nikkei 225 closed 0.19% lower at 30,183.96. U.S. stock futures were muted in early morning trading Tuesday, following a rise in bond yields the previous day that pressured growth pockets in the markets. Dow Jones Industrial Average futures rose just 30 points. S&P 500 futures were little changed, and Nasdaq 100 futures sat in negative territory. For African markets, figures are yet to roll in for Tuesday's trading. Boss Sede Abel, Business Express.
And with that, we come to the end of this edition of Business Express. We value your feedback, so keep the comments, observations, and suggestions coming. Also, be informed that all previous episodes are available on YouTube on the NTS channel. Business Express returns Wednesday at 3 p.m. I'm Leah Katung, Baba Tunde, saying keep thinking and doing business. God bless Nigeria.